When it comes to selecting a connecting rod for your next build, one of the hot topics out there that's always been controversial is whether an H-beam or an I-beam design is superior. Now, admittedly, we've actually spent a lot of effort trying to get to the bottom of this too, and there's just so many conflicting stories that we decided to get right to the heart of the topic, and we're here with Richard from CP-Carrillo. Carrillo are well known for producing some of the industry's best conrods, and we're here to find out what the exact answer to that question is. So, Richard, let's get to the bottom of it. H-beam or I-beam? Is one superior or does it just not matter?
It doesn't really matter anymore. You can design either to be equally strong for the application you're designing it for. It all has to do with the cross sections and how you design the connecting rod.
So it's really about the material in the rod and whereabouts that material is located in the beam that makes the rod strong or weak?
Correct. That is correct.
Okay, so one of the common myths that I hear about this, or let's assume that it's a myth now that we're talking about these, is that when you're designing an H-beam rod, due to the layout of the material, it by design must be heavier than an I-beam conrod. Is there any truth in that?
That's not always the case. You can design the H-beam rod to be just as light as an I-beam rod. It's how you design it.
Now, the other common myth that we hear in the industry is that between the two designs, if we have to pick a winner, and while admittedly a lot of the information suggests that the two rods are very close anyway, that it comes down to the H-beam rod is a little bit stronger for engines that are producing high cylinder pressure versus the I-beam rod is potentially a little bit superior for very high RPM engines where the rod weight is more critical. Again, is there any truth in those two topics?
There's benefits to both, but you really can design either one for either application if you design it correctly.
All right, so in Carrillo's career or history so far, you've really embraced the H-beam rod. I think that's probably what Carrillo are best known for. But more recently, we have seen you bring out designs that are an I-beam design. So can you tell us why you've moved into the I-beam design as well?
We did some I-beam stuff originally for lower horsepower applications. And then recently, we started doing some near net forged I-beam rods for a little more power, that just less cost of doing that way when you're doing near net. But other than that, that's really the only reason.
Just for those who aren't aware, that near net that you're talking about, can you explain that in a little bit more detail? What's that actually mean?
That means we actually forge the rod very close to the final product. We do machine about 90% of it. We leave the pocket of the eye section left as forged.
So that just reduces your machining time, your machining costs, and hence the cost of the finished rod?
That's correct. And this is our bullet line, which is our budget line of rods that we do.
Now, you've also got another rod that you showed me off camera earlier, which is kind of a combination of the best of both worlds. I guess you've got an H-beam design, but you've also taken some I-beam design aspects into that as well. Can you tell us why you've done that and where the advantages are?
We did that. It's an H-beam with some pockets underneath the pin and above the bearing, and that helps disperse the loads from the 6 o'clock and 12 o'clock positions around the part, so that it's not getting the hot spots that you normally see.
So more consistent bearing wear over time?
Yes, correct.
All right, so now that we've sort of dealt with the H-beam, I-beam, and really what it sounds to me like is a lot of it out there in the greater industry is really just marketing ploy as much as anything. But I also want to talk about another really hot topic, which is how someone would select a rod for their particular application. And I know that a lot of the rods that Carrillo are now producing have a horsepower rating on them. But when it comes to selecting a rod, it's really not the horsepower that's so critical. So can you talk to us about what you really need to know?
Inertial load and compressive load is very important, and that can be calculated using the bore stroke, RPM, piston assembly weight, and then combining that with the connecting rod length and weight. We can determine if a rod is going to be suitable for a given application. And that's also the same information we use for designing a connecting rod. We do use the horsepower number, but that's to determine how much cylinder pressure there is.
So really what you're more interested in from a compressive aspect is the cylinder pressure. Now, of course, the cylinder pressure is linked to the horsepower, but it's not a direct kind of correlation there. So am I right in saying basically you're giving a horsepower number because it's something that's really simple for people out on the street when they're selecting parts to decide, hey, look, 800 horsepower, I know I'm going to be under that, so I'm going to be safe?
Yeah, that's correct.
But if someone was, on the other hand, designing something that's outside of your realm of your off-the-shelf rod, so let's just say, for example, someone was building a Mitsubishi 4G63 and they wanted to make, let's say, 1600 horsepower and rev it to 11,000 RPM, probably beyond what your shelf stock part will do. So are they best to come to you and give you the design of their engine so you can actually make something suited?
Yeah, that's exactly right. This is the best way for us to design something that will live in what you're trying to do.
Now, we've talked about the compressive loading, and that obviously comes down to the horsepower, but the other side of the conrod strength, which is really important, is the tensile forces in the rod, particularly at high RPM. This becomes a problem. So can you tell us how that affects the design elements of the rod and what's critical to holding that rod together at high RPM?
Well, at high RPM, you have to select the correct bolt so that it can handle the inertial loads that it's seeing. Along with that is the design of the rod as well to maximize the inertial load capabilities of the rod itself. But if you don't have the right bolt, it's going to fail under high RPM conditions.
Look, it's been great to get some actual insight into the design of a rod. Richard, appreciate you giving us that feedback. If people want to find out more about Carrillo or maybe have Carrillo design a rod for their application, how are they best to reach out?
You can go to our website at cp-carrillo.com or call us at 949-567-9000.
Okay, great. Thanks a lot, Richard.
You're welcome.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.